And we are live. Okay. Welcome. We are going to pick up at verse 9 today. And I'm not going to do any review. Just if you want to review, listen to the tape which is posted on the blog. We begin at, I, John, your fellow Christian, and one who shares with you in suffering and ruling and patiently enduring in Jesus, was exiled on the island called Patmos for speaking God's word and the testimony of Jesus. I came under the Spirit's power on the Lord's day, and I heard a loud voice behind me like a trumpet. And then he starts talking. But God willing, we will get at least that far today. Okay. I, John, is a little bit of an unusual way of talking there. Ego, eones. There is only one other place in the New Testament where we see this sort of self-identification, and that is in Galatians 5:2, where Paul says, I, Paul. I don't know if that's significant or not, but there's a little note for you on that. It is, however, similar to how Daniel in the Old Testament often refers to himself by saying, I, Daniel. So if you really wanted a parallel for that, you would probably go to Daniel. Daniel, of course, was a prophetic book, at least weighs many portions of it. Our translation says, your fellow Christian. The actual word in the Greek is aldelphos, and it is brother, not Christian. The word brother was commonly used in the New Testament and afterwards for a fellow Christian. So Christian is an okay definition or okay translation. The NET, which we are using, actually has a lot of different possible ways that they translate it.
How do you spell that, brother?
Aldelphos?
Yes.
You can, A-D-E-L-F-O-S. I assume you don't want the Greek letters.
Nope.
You can, Delphos, you can get Philadelphia, you know, brotherly love there. So we're very close to that city. We'll give you a little bit of a feeling for that. Some of the other ways that this is translated, I don't have down here in this note. What a bummer. Okay. ET translates it in Acts 1:15, the same word, but is translated as disciples. It's also translated as fellow Christians. It can be translated as fellow Jews sometimes, if the writer, say Paul, is talking about his brothers according to the flesh, which would be his Jewish brethren, as opposed to his Christian brethren. The translators tend to try to figure out what the writer of scriptures is referring to. So, your fellow brother or Christian, and one who shares... Oh, another interesting thing about that. Do you remember how John started off by addressing us as slaves, and he was a slave, and now he says that we are brothers, your fellow brother. So just as we are fellow slaves with John, so we are also fellow brothers with John. So John does not elevate himself above. He doesn't say, you know, I was walking with Jesus, I'm the cool one, and you guys are just lucky to even be in my presence, but I'm really way above you. That's not John's way. John is very down to earth. He's one with the brothers, and he's sharing the experience. Right now, he's in exile on Patmos, and he's going to be talking about sharing the suffering with them, but also the ruling and the enduring. So he is one with us. I, John, your fellow brother, your brother, and one who shares with you in suffering. That word share is also, it's a participation in, a joining, partaking of something. It is the same root word that would be used for the Lord's Supper. It is koinonia, fellowship, and one of the big words in our district, not our district, but our Senate right now. We have service and a fellowship and witness, the big three things. Here it is sug koinonos. Sug is a word that is added, means with, so fellowship with. And we are fellowshipping with, or he is fellowshipping with us in, first off, sufferings. Not exactly what you want to be in fellowship with, per se, but in the early church, there was a lot of persecution and oppression for Christians. This particular word is used 44 times in the New Testament. And I'll just read off a few of them. Matthew 13, 21, 24, verse 9, John 16, 33, Acts 11, 19, Acts 20, 23, Romans 5, 3. And in the book of Revelation, we have it here in chapter 2, verses 9, 10, and 22, and chapter 7, verse 14. And if you were to look these up and the other possible references, you can see that this is not suffering like because you broke your leg, or suffering because you're sick, or there's been a turnaround in the economy and your bank account has been emptied out. This is oppression or suffering from the world against Christian and against Christ. And as the world rejects Christ, so it rejects the body of Christ, which is us, and it persecutes the church. You can see that around the world especially, but it is also becoming more common in our country. Unfortunately so. And we're not used to it. We're used to really being in a favored position in our country. And to have the powers move away from being supportive of the church, being supportive of Christ, is leaving a lot of Christians wondering what's going on. The message in the book of Revelation will probably become more relevant to people because it is a letter written to a church that is suffering, and John was suffering too. But in general, this is oppression from the world. This is suffering caused by the world. It could be loss of income, but not just because the economy has gone down, but you don't get a job because you're a Christian. Or at work, somebody tells you, you can't read your Bible. It makes people uncomfortable, as my wife was once told. Or I was once told when I had a job that I couldn't wear a little cross because it made one of the people uncomfortable.
Is that the Muslim story? I don't know if Lankford put it on the internet or not, but about the young man across went into the store, and it was a Muslim lady there, and she said that, put your cross away, it offends me. And he said no. So she called the manager, and he said, well, just tuck it in your shirt and everything will be all right. And he said no. And I guess one thing led to another. He left his groceries there, and said that a number of other people just left them standing there.
Well, no, this was a job that I had in Texas as a counselor. And one of the other employees there was a secular Jew. He wasn't even an observant Jew. He was a secular Jew. And I used to wear little crosses or little Luther roses, just little things. Not a big pectoral cross, just a little stick pin. And he complained to the director, and the director called me in and told me I couldn't wear it, and I said, sure I can. And I kept wearing it. But the point of the of the story is that that was back in the 80s, and things are certainly worse now, and that was oppression, that was persecution, minor as it was. I would never put myself at the same level of any of these people in the first century, or any of the Christians in the Middle East, or any of the Christians in North Africa, so forth and so on, where oppression and persecution is much severe. Nonetheless, that was a little example. Kitty worked at the Red Cross, and on her break, she used to read the Bible, and some of the ladies complained because they felt guilty when she was reading her Bible, and they were reading some smut magazine, you know, the whatever the woman's equivalent of Playboy was, and they felt bad because Kitty was reading her Bible, not saying a thing, sitting quietly off in her corner, and they were feeling guilty, so they complained, and she was told, you can't read your Bible here. So, you know, again, that's the sort of thing that was happening. That happened back in the '70s.
Did she stop?
So long ago, I don't remember. I don't think she did, but I'm not sure.
Well, yeah, I can see not reading the Bible while you're working.
Right, because you're working.
For the man. But when you're on break, do what you want.
Yeah. One would think. So the oppression of Christians in our country has increased. I imagine it's much worse. I would not want to have my particular convictions and try to be a public school teacher today. I've spoken with public school teachers across this country. Some places it's worse than others, but some places it's really bad. And they're just making it harder and harder for Christians. And when I say they, I mean the world, the unbelieving, non-Christian world. And the United States is big. And as far as our state of Delaware goes, you may not know this, but every third person you pass is a non-Christian. I'm not talking about a hardcore committed Christian. I'm talking about if you just say, are you a Christian, they'll say no. It doesn't matter if they've never been to church, haven't been to church in 25 years, but if they say, I'm a Christian, that counts as a Christian for this. Every third person will say, no, I'm not a Christian. We have a huge mission field here, just like John and his churches did. So suffering, and these people suffered in terms of economic oppression or actual physical attacks, persecutions, because this was Asia Minor, their continent, or their what they just called Asia, we call it Asia Minor. This was a hotbed of emperor worship. And each one of these towns that are getting a letter is an excise town, which means that loyalty to the emperor was prized, especially in these towns, which means being loyal to Jesus was even more difficult. And even if there wasn't a empire-wide persecution going on, there were often local persecutions put together by locals just to impress the emperor with their loyalty. So there's suffering that was very real, very physical. And ruling. Now, we've already looked at this word ruling before. This is the same word that can be translated as kingdom. Some translations actually do translate it as kingdom. And so you can sit and get in your own mind, what are they trying to get across here? If you're saying share with you in a kingdom or share in you in ruling. A kingdom, of course, is where a king rules. So they're kind of overlapping concepts, but they're not exactly the same. It is instructive that John says, even while they're in the middle of this suffering and in the middle of this patient enduring, that we are still ruling. The world, even though it does not know it, is still being led by Christ, and we are still seated with him in the heavenly places, as Peter puts it. So this is an example that I've used many times over the years. I just love it. Joseph and Mary are living comfortably, I suppose, nicely, happily, in Nazareth, which is where Jesus would have been born. But he wasn't born in Nazareth. He was born in Bethlehem. Why? What made them decide to go to Bethlehem?
Census.
That's right. Now, do you think Caesar Augustus said, oh my goodness, I need to get Joseph and Mary down to Bethlehem to fulfill the will of God? No. He had his own reasoning, his own thinking. Do you think all those other people that were trudging to their hometowns was thinking, oh, this is all part of God's plan so that Mary and Joseph can get to Bethlehem? No. They were just saying, oh, that dumb Caesar making us do this. Okay. But God is ruling. And God is using even Caesar, or who is certainly no friend of the Jewish faith, to accomplish his things. Barack Obama, we may look at it and say, golly, things are out of control. Or if you're a Barack Obama fan, then maybe you were looking at things with Bush was president saying, oh, things are out of control. But God is in control. And what's happening is happening. You look at the turmoil in the Middle East, and a lot of people are all frightened by it. But you know what has happened? There has been a flood of Muslims that have converted to Christ. In fact, a flood of them have become the Lutherans. A lot have become Roman Catholic. A lot have become Lutherans. Now, would that have happened if there had not been the toppling of Saddam Hussein? Now, that was not the plan. It was not the plan. George didn't sit in there and think, now, what's the best way for me to get Muslims to convert to Christians? He didn't think that way. But God is doing that. So, anyways, you see these terrorists. How many people have become Christians because of the terrorists? How many Muslims have looked at that and said, boy, this is lunacy, and have become Christians? God is running things. We may not know why and how, but God does.
Where did you get this information that the Muslims are converting in droves?
I've posted some of them on our blog. They're coming from the Missouri Synod, our partner church over in Germany that is doing gangbusters with catechesis and teaching these guys. And then they convert, they get baptized, and they join the church over in Germany. I was looking at a Roman Catholic site. I didn't post this on the blog, but the Roman Catholic site was talking about all the Muslims that have been coming Roman Catholics. So it's not something you're going to find on the CBS Nightly News, because, to be quite frank, the major networks don't know how to handle religion, period. It's not just that they don't know how to handle Christian themes. They don't know how to handle any religious thing. Muslims, they haven't a clue about the differences in the types of Muslims. Not clue one. They don't have a clue about the differences in Hinduism or anything. If you're talking religion, don't bother with the national news. They just don't get it. They don't understand. A few exceptions, but not many. Not many. So anyways, Christ is ruling, and John is sharing in that just as you are. Got a wonderful quote in here from a gal named Dawn, and Marva Dawn, I think it is, her quote. Let me see if I can find it here real quick. Yes, okay. There is much scholarly debate about the meaning of the word kingdom, the extent to which Jesus understood his role in its coming and fulfillment, and the significance of his ethics for the meanwhile before its culmination. The word kingdom means, of course, the place or people over which a king reigns. But in the Bible, the word emphasizes more the way in which God's kingdom affects the lives of all who engage in it. Christ's kingdom, then, changes all those for whom his lordship is supreme, who acknowledge that he is ruler over everything. When Jesus began preaching in Galilee, he announced that the kingdom of God had come. The Greek perfect verb recording that announcement means literally that in a decisive moment, the kingdom came and consequently remains in effect. Such a verb form underscores the truth that in his coming, Jesus indeed brought the reign of God to bear on those who were present, and that in his reign, Jesus changes everything forever. The coming of Jesus changed the world radically, decisively, permanently. For those who believe in him, the reign of God continues to hold sway even in persecution. Now, under his lordship, they would choose to seek the fulfillment of his purpose in their lives. Furthermore, when Jesus sent out the disciples to proclaim the kingdom, for example, Luke 9 and 10, he sent them with this message: the kingdom of God has drawn near. Once again, the Greek perfect verb underscores the fact that in them the kingdom had been brought, and it would continue to exist wherever God's people go. What exciting things can happen when we join in action of God's incursion into human history and life and become reoriented to God's future. When we recognize the precious commodity we carry with us, in us, through us, wherever we go. Have you ever stopped to think that you bring the kingdom of God to your local grocery store, just like the story you were talking about? But you do it too. When you go to your local grocery store, kingdom of God is breaking into that store. John's introduction reminds us that we are fellow participants in the reign of God. We bring his kingdom wherever we go. Moreover, because we are fellow sharers in it, we together bring it wherever we go. This is one of the most important parts of the vision necessary to sustain us, a recognition of the community in which the kingdom of God is experienced. We are not alone as we seek to bring the reign of Christ to bear on the situations of our time. Just as John was there to encourage those struggling under the emperor's persecution, so we have each other to be fellow participants in both the tribulations and the kingdom as we live today. And I just like that, you know, the kingdom of God. We're in the kingdom of God, and we bring the kingdom of God. When you go to the gas station, you could say, the kingdom of God has drawn near, you know, because you're part of that kingdom. So anyways, So there we have ruling and patiently enduring. And this is an interesting word also. It's a hupomone. And if you wanted to write that down, you might go H-U-P-O-M-O-N, long A, however you want it, E with a line over it, or A with a line over it, or whatever. And it means steadfast endurance. It's not a passive walk all over me kind of a thing. It is, I'm going to stand my ground. Not in the sense of, I'm going to knock you on your can, stand your ground, but you can't knock me down kind of thing. I don't care what you say. I don't care what you do. You cannot separate me from the love of God in Christ Jesus. You can even march me into the center of the arena and let the lions loose. I am going to remain true. You can send me to the island of Patmos. I'm going to remain true. And we will see in our letters all sorts of cruelties that were done, and the histories are replete with how the Christians were persecuted and yet remained fast. We continue to see this witness today, where Christians are willing to suffer and die rather than recant their faith. Christians will let their heads be cut off rather than lose their faith. I'm reminded of when the Augsburg Confession was presented in 1530, and the princes went forward with that confession, and the emperor was there, and of course the emperor was top dog from a human, political, military point of view. And they got down on their knees and they said, you can cut our heads off, but we will not recant. Of course, the emperor didn't want to do that. But the point of the matter is they were willing to give up their life. They patiently endured. They didn't say, if you won't accept this, we're going to take up arms and fight against you. They didn't say that. That would not have been an example of this. They were willing to stand firm no matter what. Luther, when he said, here I stand, God help me, I can't do anything else. Again, this sort of endurance. It's not, I'm going to beat you up, but it's also, I'm not going to give in. One other thing I'd like to bring out here is that as John is writing this to his brothers, and he is the one who shares with you this suffering and ruling and patient endurance. It's one thing for me to sit here in the comforts of a really nice church in Delaware and write a stirring letter to the Christians in Egypt, encouraging them to stand fast no matter what. And if they receive that, they've got to wonder, where does this guy get off? I mean, really, I'm going to stand fast. What does that mean? Okay, my boss gives me dirty looks because I wear a cross on my lapel. Or my boss calls me in and says, you really should stop reading that Bible on your break because it makes people uncomfortable. Okay. I said that those were little examples. But over in Egypt, where they got this Muslim Brotherhood running around crucifying Christians, where do I get off telling them to stand firm? You know, in the comfort of my home, nice theory. Okay? Nice theory. They are practicing. So when one of theirs says stand firm, it's going to make a bigger impact. And when one of them is willing to suffer and die for the Lord, the others in Egypt sees that and says, see, that's what it is. That's what it means to be a Christian. The church in, I think, Ethiopia it is, the Lutheran church in Ethiopia, is just growing by gangbusters. I mean, the Ethiopian Lutheran church has more Lutherans than all of North America. Wow. Not the United States, I mean Mexico, the United States, and Canada. More Lutherans in that one denomination. Harrison, our president, asked him, what's the secret for this phenomenal growth? And he said, persecution. But we can talk about standing firm, and we should talk about standing firm. But the chances of one of us being stoned to death for our faith, pretty small.
Getting blown up, it's getting bigger. Bigger chance.
Better chance today than maybe 20 years ago.
Well, I would think that if Greg or you, me, anybody here, would write a letter to a friend in Egypt, fellow Christians, and want them to stand firm, it means also that we are standing firm and we would give up all of our comforts here also.
And ideally, that's exactly true. But personally, I could see them wondering. John stands with them, and it's not just words. He's an exile. You know, he has walked a walk. I don't think that he volunteered to go in exile. Just like I'm not going to volunteer to be crucified. On the other hand, I would love to think that if push came to shove, I would stand firm. But I would look, Ralph Harrison is a wonderful president, but he's not had to give his life.
He was never challenged to do so.
Well, that's right.
If a radical would walk in tonight, would there be, and we couldn't quote the Quran, would there be five bodies here tomorrow morning, or would there be nobody?
Well, I would like to think that we would all stand firm. I would like to think that we'd all stand firm. I think that if we did stand firm, our witness would have more credibility in the eyes of others. And that's all I'm saying. And John here is writing from the point of view of one who has not just words of encouragement, but is also one who has experienced with them the suffering and the patient endurance, as well as the ruling. And that ruling is something that gives us encouragement in the face of trials and tribulations, because we realize that all things are working together for the good of those who love the Lord, who are called according to his purposes. Was our translation said exiled on the island called Patmos. Now that word exile is not in the Greek. They just put that in there so that we would know, because we're kind of dumb and we would not know that he was there in exile. We would think he was there taking a little summer vacation or something. Anyways, you don't want to make a whole lot out of that word, but on the island called Patmos, and we already talked about that island in our introduction, so unless somebody really wants to learn more about Patmos, we'll just move right on.
Was it a bad place?
Yes.
It
was where they sent exiles. They had mines there that the exiles had to work in. Needless to say, they weren't paid. John was an old man. Chances are he didn't have to work in the mines, although some of the commentators wax eloquent about how this old man is pulling the stuff out of the mines and so forth. And it's possible, but chances are they just looked at him and said, this guy can't do any work. Go run around up there in the mountains and get lost and die of hunger or something like that. But it is possible that he worked the mines, and it was not a fun place. So he's on Patmos, exiled. Now, notice how this is grouped. For speaking God's word and the testimony of Jesus. You remember we said twos reflect the word of God and preaching and so forth. I should be pointing these things out all the time, but I'm not. So at least ways I'm point them out occasionally. And as you look through your text, you can draw those things out yourself. He's there for because of his Christian witness. And his Christian witness is speaking God's word and the testimony of Jesus. And those are in parallel. So God's word is the testimony of Jesus, and the testimony of Jesus is God's word. In other words, John is underscoring that the New Testament, the Gospels and so forth, that is the inspired word of God. And that's what he is proclaiming. And he's talking about, obviously, the incarnation, the life, the death, the resurrection of Jesus, his ascension, and his eventual return. And these are the things that Rome cannot tolerate. Rome doesn't mind having all sorts of gods as long as you include Caesar in there. Falsehood is multitudinous. There can be a thousand false answers and only one correct. You may seem terribly intolerant if you insist that 2 + 2 = 4. Why not 5? Why not 6? Why not 7? Some people want it to be 2. Other people want it to be 11. Some people say 22. And there are all these wrong answers. But when you turn that in to your teacher in the first grade, only one answer is going to be marked correct. And when it comes to religion, there's only one answer that's marked correct by God. And that's Jesus Christ. That's what we confessed earlier in the Apostles' Creed. That has been where the church has stood, that Trinitarian faith. And that's what he was speaking, and that's why he got exiled. I came under the Spirit's power. Now we get to our handout spirit, there we go, that I gave you. Okay. Now, in Greek, when you're writing in Greek, as John would have been writing this, there would have been no capital letters. Capital letters are only used, or predominantly used, on monuments, and if you have a fraternity, and you want to pretend like you know Greek. Okay. So, whether or not this is referring to the Holy Spirit or like a person's spirit would not be determined by how it's spelled, whether it has a capital letter or a lowercase letter, because it would have been a lowercase letter even if it was referring to the Holy Spirit. So, if we look at the Greek text, it's not a capital letter, but that's not decisive. Now, if you look at biblical translations, overwhelmingly they pick a capital S, okay? If you look at the commentaries, overwhelmingly they pick a lowercase s. So the commentators are at odds with the translators on this. There, I do a little word study on this that I've given you, and a pneuma is the word that we're talking about in the Greek. And it can have an article, the word the, in front of it, or it can be without an article. If it has an article in front of it, it's almost always the Holy Spirit, even though it doesn't say holy. If it says Holy Spirit, obviously, we're no longer discussing this at all. However, in this particular case, there is no article. That means that we are left to look at the text and try to figure out whether we think it's referring to the Holy Spirit or not the Holy Spirit. I have here in this word study for you every reference to the word spirit in the book of Revelation, and I indicate whether or not there is an article being used. And then you can use that to help understand or make up your mind on this particular question. Now the word pneuma is broader than the word spirit. It can mean breath, it can mean wind, it can be like my spirit, myself, my soul, if you will. For example, Revelation 11:11 says, a breath, pneuma, of life. And in that particular case, the word life is zoes, which would be eternal life, not bios, which would be physical life. Then in Revelation 13:15, there's no article in, to put breath, pneuma, spirit, you know, wind into the image. This is clearly not the Holy Spirit in that particular case. So you can look those up and will help you to determine what you believe. Now, I personally, in spite of some very good minds, think that it's really a lowercase s. Now, the way they have translated here, they clearly think that we're Holy Spirit. So it says, I came under the Spirit's power. That's not what the Greek says, okay? The Greek says, and let me just translate this right here. I came in spirit, okay? And I believe they have here also a footnote for this. There we go. Literally, I came to be in spirit. Okay. So if you take that literal, I came to be in spirit, all of a sudden it doesn't seem so obviously the Holy Spirit. And we as Christians walk according to the Spirit and not according to the flesh.
That's on the next page, it's pretty plain. Down to the paragraph above.
Okay. On a certain day, John was in spirit. This phrase, in spirit, denotes a spiritual state in which he was able to see and hear things that ordinarily are not seen and heard, the state in which visions are perceived. Many translators render the phrase in pneumatics, in the spirit, capital S. This is a possible translation. However, the absence of the article in the Greek and the fact that there is no other indication in the context that the word is a proper name seems to make the translation in spirit, lowercase s, preferable. And that's by Becker. That's a quote from Becker. You will note that Brighton disagrees with him. And they are both outstanding Lutheran scholars. So this is something that Lutherans disagree on. And if you had a former pastor who did this and he was sure that it was the Holy Spirit, God bless him, he's wrong, but I will not kick him out of the Senate. Okay. So I think especially because it's tied in with the Lord's Day, and I think in terms of worship, I think in terms of that state where you're meditating on the Word of God, you're singing hymns, and you're kind of in the groove, kind of in the flow, and it's just a very spiritual thing, okay? But if you want to go Holy Spirit, you can do it. That's fine. I have both sides of the argument in there. So anyways, I came to be in the Spirit on the Lord's Day. And you'll find this interesting. This is the first time, right here, the first time in all of history that we have a reference to the Lord's Day written. Now, clearly, John uses this. Everybody who reads this knows what he's talking about. So it was a common phrase, at least ways, in the province of Asia. That is what we call today Asia Minor, again. It was what they understood to be the day where Jesus was worshipped. And it is distinct from and different from the Sabbath. Sabbath, I'm sure you know, was Saturday. And we still have our calendars laid out that way. If you look at your wall calendar, what is the seventh day on your wall calendar?
Saturday.
Sunday is the first day of the week. The Lord's Day is Sunday, and it is the day that the church began worshiping practically immediately. We see it in the book of Acts, where they are gathering to worship on the first day of the week. That is the Lord's Day. It is called the Lord's Day because Jesus rose on a Sunday. It is called the Lord's Day because the Holy Spirit was given on a Sunday. Pentecost was a Sunday as well. These two major New Testament events reoriented the people of God. And then we have the New Testament teaching where Jesus has fulfilled the ceremonial law, and therefore we are no longer bound by the ceremonial law. We are bound by the moral law, which is worship God, the one true God, but we are not bound by the ceremonial law. Therefore, we don't have to circumcise. It's okay if you're circumcised. It's adiaphora. That means it's indifferent. But we don't have to avoid shrimp. If you want to avoid shrimp, by all means, avoid shrimp. But we don't have to. It's not a more blessed state. You don't have to avoid pork chops or ribs. If you want to, go ahead and avoid them. But it's no spiritual thing to do.
What was shrimp? That's the first time I heard that. Pork, yes. But
shellfish of any kind. You couldn't have shrimp. You couldn't have lobster. Couldn't have crabs. You know, all these things that people love around here. Yeah, can't have that shellfish. Had been superseded by Christ, as was the days, the feasts, the festivals, because they were all fulfilled in Christ. It's not that Jesus changed it, it's that Jesus fulfilled it. For example, Jesus fulfills the Sabbath in his death. He rested on the Sabbath and was raised. The Sabbath was intended to point to the death and burial and resurrection of Christ. He has died, he has been buried, and he has risen. The reason pointing that the Sabbath has done has been fulfilled. The other is yet to be fulfilled, and that is when we go to heaven. It's also a pointing, but the promised land is more pointing towards that. And so our new life is in Christ. And the Lord's Day is Sunday. So I came to be in the Spirit on the Lord's Day. And I heard a loud voice behind me like a trumpet. Okay. We're not going to have a chance to look at it, but because we're almost out of time. But we'll take a quick glance. I have a loud voice behind me like a trumpet. Before you, in this mess, is every reference to a trumpet or horn in the Old Testament. And there are quite a few, as you can see. And you can look through this, and the idea behind looking through all of these passages is to try to get a feel for what is John trying to communicate, or what more precisely is Jesus trying to communicate by a voice like a trumpet. Now, it is clearly a simile because he says as, he doesn't say and a trumpet sounded, but he said there was a voice as a trumpet, like a trumpet. So it's a simile that's going on. So you look through this and you ask yourself, what about a trumpet connects here? Volume, certainly. Clarity, certainly. A lot of commentators, that's as far as they want to go. But if you look at these other things, you'll find that trumpets are associated with a lot of things. Especially associated with trumpets is calling people to worship. We, you know, with our medieval background, kind of think of bells. Let's ring the bells and people will come. Well, in the Old Testament, they blew the trumpets and people came to worship. So perhaps we have some worship overtones here. We have the suffering and ruling and patiently enduring because of the trials and tribulations, where trumpets were blown in battle, much like we still think of a bugle sounding charge or retreat. Trumpets were used in battle for both charge and retreat. Every time a king, well, maybe not every time, but often when a king would be coronated, there would be playing of trumpets. Perhaps we see some of that ruling imagery being reinforced with the trumpet sound. So you can look through all of these things and ask yourself, how might I take some of this imagery and apply it here? And then there's just this whole slew of questions that I have here. And then at the back it says, your thoughts. So what we will do next time, this will be fun. You can look over this stuff. And then we'll start off with your thoughts. You just tell me, was this a waste of time? a pious exercise on my part. And that third handout that I made, we will begin next time because it more relates actually to the seven churches and a very, very foolish idea that is popular even to this day and has been popular now for about 150 years on how to interpret the churches, and it's really a bogus idea. So that brings us to the end of our time. Why don't we close with the Lord's Prayer. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. There's one thing I wanted to mention that I forgot. The word Lord here on Lord's Day is an unusual word for Lord. And it's only used in one other place in the Bible, and it's in reference to the Lord's Supper. So I just thought I'd point that out.